take you back to the past to play the shitty games that suck ass. He'd rather have a buffalo.
I've been called upon to take care of business once again. Apparently, there is a game worse than Big Rigs. Worse than Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Worse than Crazy Bus or Desert Bus. It is known as Hong Kong 97, and I've been getting requests for it up the ass. The requests are so far up the ass, it's time to shit them out. The game was made for the Super Famicom in Japan, but never saw its way to the rest of the world. This is one title that we definitely didn't get on the Super Nintendo. It was made by HappySoft. HappySoft was most famous for making Hong Kong 97, their one and only masterpiece. On this one occasion, they rose from the depths of hell, excreted this unholy turd onto the earth, and then descended back to where they came. Supposedly, the game was so horrible, it barely even came out on the Super Famicom at all. Stores rejected it, and its release status is a mystery. It's so rare that to this day, not a single cartridge or physical copy has shown up at all. I can't even find a picture of one. So the only way I can experience this game is the same way as the rest of the internet. No! No way! How do you like that soundtrack? That won't get annoying at all! I've heard games with 5-second music loops before, but not with lyrics! There's options for 3 different languages. Strange considering how the game didn't travel very far, at least not until the internet got a hold of it. Alright, I'm picking English. We will sell your original SNES games. 1/3 of the gross profit will be yours. We welcome games of any kind. Oh, I bet. So please send us your floppy. Send us your floppy. Would you like to sell our products at your store? We're looking for dealers worldwide. Enough already! How desperate could they be to sell this game? And I guess still nobody bought it because nobody can find a physical copy. Then finally the title screen appears. Jackie Chan. Apparently Jackie Chan is in the game, who I doubt gave any consent to HappySoft or was even aware of it. The image is stolen from the film Wheels on Meals. The game was released, made, or at least copyrighted in 1995, but set in the future of 1997. The year 1997 has arrived. A herd of... This can't be real. No. No, somebody's pulling my leg. A herd of fucking ugly reds? Was a herd of ugly reds too weak? Did they really need the F word to fucking drive home the fucking point? This was before cursing in games was common. I remember how shocked I was when I first played Rambo on NES and saw the word hell. But here, they dropped the F-bomb! They did it! A game made for the Super Famicom! It's the closest you'd ever get to a Super Nintendo game that says fuck. And the music is still going. A herd of fucking ugly reds, period, are rushing from the mainland. Crime rates skyrocketed. Hong Kong is ruined. Therefore, the Hong Kong government called Bruce Lee's relative, Chin. Bruce Lee's relative. Just happens to be as skilled as Bruce Lee. Not a brother, a son, or even a cousin. Just some unspecified relative. It doesn't make any sense. Like, if you were related to, I don't know, Michael Jordan, would that mean that you're automatically good at basketball? Okay, so Bruce Lee is in the background, the guy at the podium is Chris Patton, former governor of Hong Kong, and over there is Jackie Chan. Which one is Chin? for the Massacre of the Reds. Chin is a killer machine. That's Chin?
It's Jackie Chan playing Bruce Lee's relative Chin.
Oh, Chin. What a name. Could it be any more common?
Oh, wipe out 1.2 billion of the Red Communists. Stop. I can't take anymore. I haven't even seen the game yet. Oh. Wipe out 1.2 billion people.
And if I'm not mistaken, in 1995, that would have been the entire population of China. Bruce Lee's relative is so powerful, he's the equivalent of 1,000 nukes. He's gonna murder the entire population of China by breaking their necks. Even when Bruce Lee would take down 20 people, it took him a little bit of time. But now comes Chin. You don't fuck with Chin. However, in mainland China, there is a secret project in progress. A project to transform the deceased Tang Xiaoping into an alternate... It's killing me. So apparently, for the character of Tang Xiaoping, they used an actual image of a real Chinese leader, Deng Xiaoping. Spelled differently, but pronounced very similar. When the game was made, this guy was still alive. Couldn't they have at least had the courtesy to wait for him to die before transforming him into an ultimate weapon? This is the most epic, absurd opening to any video game I've ever seen. Nothing compares! That'd be like if I made a game called New York 2017. Motherfucking demons from the planet Jupiter have arrived through the Manhattan portal. The leader of United States calls upon Master Joe, John Wayne's half-cousin's stepson, to annihilate the 2.5 octodecillion alien scum of the universe. However, on Jupiter's secret moon, a master plan is conceived to resurrect the astro-demonoid Dill Clinton into a mecha doomsday machine. Now that I've digested all that, let's play the game. One hit and the game's over. Why would I expect anything more? No. Oh, please. I hope that's not a real dead body. No, there's no way they'd have such bad taste. That's gotta be an actor. Or we're looking at some guy who died on that date and time in 1992. Oh, this couldn't get the Nintendo endorsement? I'm so shocked that this didn't come out on Super Nintendo. Every time you die, it resets the whole game. You have to go through the whole introduction again. This is almost as tedious as Castlevania Symphony of the Night. Great game, but you have to wait through a long, drawn-out game over screen just to get back to the title screen, select your file, and load the game all over again. That is some fucking bullshit. But this is a game that isn't even good. Not even close. And no, the song never stops. No sound effects either, just that same loop. Even when the game restarts, it doesn't interrupt it. The song never needs to reboot. It's quite impressive, actually. Nothing can stop that loop. You'll be hearing that in your dreams. So let's talk about what's happening here. Obviously, it's a 2D shooter. Nothing more to say. What you see is what you get. Chin's only method of attack is throwing projectiles, because if you're related to Bruce Lee, that means you can shoot white balls. This guy is so good, he does it all with his back turned. Everybody he hits, they don't just die, they burst into an atomic fucking explosion! And it's inside a square, like they just slapped a picture of a mushroom cloud on there. Why is the background Coca-Cola? Did they run out of ideas? Like, what should we put there? Anybody got any ideas? Anybody? Coca-Cola. All right. You know, there is a movie called Hong Kong 97. It came out in 94, 1 year before this game. That can't be a coincidence. So I'm gonna consider this a movie-based game. Just so I can say it has nothing to do with the movie. In less than 5 minutes, the final boss appears, Tang Xiaoping, played by Deng Xiaoping, who has been transformed into a so-called ultimate weapon. What kind of ultimate weapon is that? He's just a head! After you kill him, the game continues and loops endlessly, so there's no real ending to the game. Unless maybe you kill 1.2 billion people without getting hit once, but who would ever try that? The strange thing is that Deng Xiaoping actually died in 1997. The game predicted the future. In fact, 1997 was the year the United Kingdom returned their rule of Hong Kong back to China. The movie from 94 forecasts this in the tagline, 99 years of British rule are about to come to an end. Hong Kong will never be the same. The movie stars Robert Patrick, the T-1000 from Terminator 2, Judgment Day. And Judgment Day takes place in 1997. Part of Deng Xiaoping's ear is sort of cut off. Like when Mike Tyson bit off a piece of Evander Holyfield's ear in 1997. The car, I'm willing to bet, is a Mercedes-Benz in which Princess Diana died in 97. And what was the year Coca-Cola launched Surge? 97. And it's no coincidence all my Surge protectors were made in China. Rebooting the entire game after you die, just like Symphony of the Night, 97. Jackie Chan, Rumble in the Bronx, New York City, the Big Apple. The year Steve Jobs returned to Apple in 97. The unstoppable, unrelenting song is called I Love Beijing Tiananmen, also known as I Love Peking Tiananmen. Peking duck is a famous duck dish from Beijing. And Scrooge McDuck had his 50th anniversary in 97. The game was such a titanic failure. Titanic, the movie from 97. Why was this game's sole purpose to direct us to the number 97? Huh. Like the NGC 97 galaxy in the constellation of Andromeda. The Princess Andromeda, who was chained naked to a rock to be sacrificed to a monster. Like Princess Leia and Jabba in Return of the Jedi. The special edition of Star Wars in 97. Oh, fuck, we're back again. Man, I was just trying to get a final answer here, but I went full circle. Like the song that keeps looping. A game that keeps repeating. Maybe it's all about a cycle. An endless cycle. Old shitty games that become new again. The past becomes the future. Birth and death, on and on. It's a cycle of life. The game is the meaning of life. And the thing that keeps life going, reproduction and food, which becomes shit. The game is fucking shit there. I've done that one. Let's see. Shitty. I've done that one too. Shitty games. This one looks pretty shitty. Yeah, it's shitty. Just flying around shooting frogs and bubbles in space. Oh, that's not enough material to work with. I'm moving on. Here's one. Yay, this sucks. Kid Nicky's jumping around like he's on the moon. It's ass. Nah. Oh, now this looks hilarious. My mind is a blank. There's gotta be something. Oh, death bots. How could you go wrong? Or right? Or rightfully wrong? Shooting robots. Okay. I got it. Mad Max. It was made by Mindscape, proving that not every NES movie-based game was made by LJN. See, LJN was like a cat, and the NES library was its litter box. When the litter box gets too shitty, the cat shits somewhere else. Now I'm on track. Well, you drive around, you run around shooting people, you drive, shoot, buy stuff, drive and shoot. I wish it were LJN because they would have given me more to talk about. Call me an explorer. I've been searching for the perfect shitty game. And I've seen just about everything at this point. But you know what? I'm gonna do something that I've never done yet. And that is to review a game on... the TurboGrafx-16. Holy shit. The TurboGrafx-16 was developed by Hudsonsoft and NEC. Its original name in Japan was the PC Engine, which sounds like a computer on a train. No wonder they changed it. The games came on cards, which was unique. It was technically the first 16-bit console, made to compete with the NES, but it was soon trampled by two titans, the Sega Genesis and the Super Nintendo. Yeah, you were either asking your parents for the Genesis or the SNES. The TurboGrafx-16 was the one nobody gave a shit about. It didn't have as many third-party game developers working for it, but the benefit of that was that it meant less shitty games. The TurboGrafx library is less contaminated than the rest. That's why it's taken me so long to get to it. There's no major stinkers that stick out. But I might have found one. Darkwing Duck, based on the TV show. I remember the show, but I'm not overly familiar with it, which is a fair spot to be in. I have no high expectations or low expectations. By now, I've played some of the most horrible games that are humanly possible to make. Plumbers Don't Wear Ties, Big Rigs, Hong Kong 97. I think I've set the bar too high, or too low, depending which way you look at it. So now, let's get into some more sensible territory. Let's get serious. Or should I say, let's get dangerous. Fuck. You son of a bitch. You piece of dog shit. Fuck, they think we are fucking pieces of shit. It begins with a stage selection screen. You move a magnifying glass over a photograph of the villains. By selecting a villain, you load their stage. That's pretty unique, I have to say. As you can see, it's a standard action side-scroller. Nothing much to explain. The graphics are satisfactory for this era. I guess I'm not supposed to be able to reach that D. Come on. Come on! Figured I could get a running start, but that doesn't work. Great, the game just began and they tease you with an item that you can't get. There's gotta be a way. Oh, I see, you bounce on the skateboarding penguins' heads. How could I be so casual when I say skateboarding penguins? Wait, why didn't it work? Oh, is it a fluke the first time? Oh, maybe I bounce on this thing? Nope. It's not like I have to get the D. I don't even know what it does, but it pisses me off. I feel like an ass. I can't let that go. I feel like I've been fooled. It's like a test from the game programmers, a challenge. Like, you put that D there, and I'm gonna figure out how you intend I get to it. I believe this is possible. All I gotta do is bounce on one of these penguins. Why would it be so difficult? You know why? The penguins don't come when you're anywhere near the D. No, you gotta walk way out there before they start coming, and at that point they're so fast you lose them. Ah, I'll stun them with my gun, then bounce off them. I just gotta get one of them over to the D. Fuck, fuck! I give up. There's a whole game ahead of me. Fuck the D! The D can suck my dick! I have to mention, the controls are very delayed. You'd never know just by looking at it, no. You'd have to play it for yourself. Or, how about listen to me hit the button? You hear that? That's how delayed it is. Okay, here's Tusker Nini. Immune to gunfire, apparently. I suppose I have to jump on him or over him. And that's so convenient when you're going uphill. Oh, no, 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 no! No! Oh, I have an idea. Nope. Gotta admit, it was a pretty smart idea. I accept that I have to take a hit. Can I just get past him? Whew, thank God. Oh, no! I've been playing on normal mode. I'm changing it to easy. Huh. Easy and normal. Should be called hard and fucking bullshit. Is this guy gonna die or what? Finding ammo isn't that common, and I just wasted it all on one guy. What a shitload of fuck. Here's the final showdown with Tusker Nini. Okay, so the idea is to jump on him. I did it once. Why can't I do it again? Oh, sorry, I shit myself. How did the bags hit me? I was standing perfectly in between them. The hit detection in this game seems to be spontaneous.
I can usually adapt to crap, but this game is a rare breed where I legitimately can't figure out what I'm doing wrong. It's a type of game designed to make it appear that you're playing real poorly, to make you question, is it really you? But it's the delayed controls and strange hit detection. Now all of a sudden it worked? Nothing has any rhyme or reason. Things go on diagonal slant so you can't tell what part you're allowed to jump on. Hazardous objects still harm you even when you clearly jump over them, as if there's some kind of invisible electric barrier around them. Don't you think there'd be a reason why the window is broken? Doesn't it look like I can hop down there? How about hanging on the power lines? Darkwing is actually reaching up as if he could grab on, but it never happens. It messes with your mind. It's a psychological sucker front, a facade. It's the equivalent of an open door that you can't go in. Another brain teaser they throw at you is this puzzle. As you progress in the game, you get more pieces of the puzzle to work with. The annoying part is that they put two characters behind the puzzle, so sometimes I can't tell if I'm looking at the puzzle or at a piece of the background. Just have a flat color! Jeez! Is it fucking rocket science? Oh, look at all those goodies up there. Jump on the bat. Jump on the bat! I give up. Why a kick in the ass? What kind of game is this where you can sometimes jump on things and other times can't? So much shit coming at me! So much shit! What the fuck just happened? It's like you make one wrong step, you go to the dungeon, bitch! What is this thing anyway? A pizza that turns into a capybara? You can't duck and shoot. Great. Well, at least you can duck. You are a duck. I don't know what kind of fucked up duck can't fucking duck. Get up there. Get up there! Get the fuck up there! With these kind of controls, you should not be required to do platform jumping. And just about now. Fuck. Let's try again. Wait for it. Nope. Not now. Next time, and here it comes. If you stand still for too long, a safe drops on you. Like the game is saying, fuck you. Might as well just be a giant middle finger, and it should be the only part of the game in 3D. Put on your 3D glasses, get ready, set, fuck you, kids! This could have been a decent game. Darkwing Duck is not one of those concepts that's doomed from the start. The show had elements of action, crime-solving, and humor. It's been done well before. There is an NES version, which was basically like Mega Man, but with a duck. It was made by Capcom, who of course made the Mega Man games, and DuckTales. Those all turned out great. So what happened here? The control isn't just bad, it's uniquely bad in an indescribable way. Every game with bad control has its own feel, its own identity. Making bad games is an art form. It's a delicate recipe. Some are worse than others. It might be a massive truckload of elephant shit or a pellet of bird poop. To explain exactly how bad it is, I've invented the shit scale. It begins with games that are debatably bad, somewhat good games with serious flaws, not part of the turd crust, but well within smell range. Then you get to the high level of shit contamination, games that are possible to play, but nobody in their right mind would. Then you get into the very high category, which encompasses the majority of LJN games. This is where you could still survive, but you'd come out traumatized for life. Next is the severe zone. This is for masochists only. These are games that could kill a person. Stay away. Don't even think about it. Then we have Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Enough said. Finally, at the extreme end of the scale, major code red, we have games that don't even qualify as games at all. They shouldn't even be on the scale, but they are. And that's so you know to beware. Never play them, never talk about them. So where does Darkwing Duck fall on the scale? I'd say somewhere around here.
Of course, that means there are games that are worse, but from what I've seen so far, Darkwing Duck is the worst game on the TurboGrafx-16. Being the worst at something is quite an achievement. I'm the fucking nerd. I'll see you next time.
He's the angry Atari, Amiga, CDI, ColecoVision, and Television, Sega, Neo Geo, TurboGrafx-16, Odyssey, 3DO, Commodore, Nintendo nerd. He's the angry video game nerd.
Finally, it's time to play something on the Dreamcast, the final game console from Sega. The fact that I've never before reviewed a Dreamcast game is a testament to the greatness of the console. There just weren't that many shitty games that I'm aware of. It was a good piece of hardware for Sega to go out with after many ups and downs. So what brings the occasion? Well, the fans have fished out this gem for me, because that's what y'all do, is feed me with game requests to keep me going. And they say this is one of the strangest games ever made, and it happens to be called Semen. No, I'm not going there. So what do you do in this game? Well, the instructions say you're free to enjoy semen. Oh, no, 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 no! It's Semen! Semen! Not semen. As in jizz! Splooge! Man bazooka juice! The manual says go to meetseaman.com. The website no longer exists, but I heard it was once a porn site. I just heard, that's all. A Dreamcast game that sends you to porn. More like wet Dreamcast. Set the time? Since when did video game consoles start telling time? I have a clock. A rolling rock clock. I don't need this shit. I can wear a watch. Or a watch is not cool enough. No, no, no. Kids nowadays, they just look at their phones. Yeah, I'd look so cool going around telling time on my phone. Yeah, you wanna look cool? Put a Sega Dreamcast on your wrist with a TV and a gas-powered electric generator. You'd be so awesome. Let's play this.
You'll witness before you a phenomenon like no other. My name is Leonard Nimoy, and I will be your guide.
No. No way. Leonard Nimoy? Spock himself is the voice of the Seaman game on Sega Dreamcast? In the name of fuck. How do I get involved in this shit? I gotta figure it out. I gotta do it. I gotta do it for Nimoy. Okay, so to pick up the egg, you have to hit X and the right trigger at the same time. Why couldn't it just be X? Oh, maybe the idea is to go like this, you know, like you're grabbing something. Yeah, well, grab my scrote! It's 2015. It's time to start saying scrote.
Then take the egg from the storage matrix.
Yeah, when he says matrix, he sounds like Galvatron. Okay, let's drop the egg in the tank. Now what? Well, thank God for the instructions. So you have to raise the heat up to a certain range, and then just wait for the egg to hatch. Alright, while the game does its thing, let's read up on a little history. According to the manual, the species that we will be raising was originally discovered in Egypt in the 1930s by a French anthropobioarchaeologist, Jean-Paul Gasset. His hypothesis suggests that the creature was responsible for transferring knowledge and language across the land during the Third Dynasty. The creature is said to be the reincarnation of a pharaoh's son who fell in love with a priest's daughter who was turned into a fish by the god Thoth, and the pyramids were built by the priest as a beacon to guide the pharaoh's son back where he was eventually found again! Well, they definitely put a lot of thought into it. That's a lot of backstory for a game where you just stare at an egg! Oh, wait. It multiplied. Now this is getting interesting.
Ah, it's repulsive! Whoa. Ah! Oh! Oh my god! Ah! Get away from me, you mystical ancient pharaoh motherfuckers! Oh, I gotta do it. I gotta do it for Nimoy! For Nimoy! Weird.
Forker bell.
Did it just say fucker bell? No, I just always want there to be cursing in retro games. Here's where the most important part of the game comes in, the speech. That's right, this microphone isn't just for decoration. This is how you talk to the seamen. Hello?
Hello.
It's alive. The creatures evolve slowly over time. This is a game all about patience. You spend most of the time waiting as things happen. You feed the fish, raise the heat back up, raise the oxygen, talk to the seamen, and keep them to live long and prosper. That's about all there is to it. You turn off the game, come back to it a day later, or 5 minutes later, like me.
You visit often. If one didn't know better, one might assume you're quite obsessed. Or you have nothing better to do.
Oh, I have better things to do! Hello?
Yeah, hello. Whatever.
I just want to talk.
Blah, blah, blah. Happy?
Yo, fuckface!
Let's be sure and get my name right, skin puppet. You're a pain in the ass.
Suck my dick!
Hey, seaman, don't play that.
What can I do? I'll tickle you.
Are you coming on to me?
Tickle, 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 tickle!
I'm gonna pee if you don't stop. Oh, I come from Alabama with my banjo on my knee.
Okay.
At the moment, the habitat contains 2 gill men.
The only gill man I know is the creature from the Black Lagoon. In order to advance the gill man through his evolutionary stages, you have to answer his questions.
Is your mom still working or not?
He'll ask you your birthday, your father's birthday, your mother's birthday, religion, politics. Seriously, this little bastard wants to know everything about you. But he only asks the questions when he feels like it. So you have to wait until he's in the right mood, which could take hours.
I'm mad at you right now, so go away.
Talk, talk. Speak, speak.
Yeah, bite me.
Did he just take a shit? He just flung shit at me! Well, there's nothing I can do right now. The instruction manual says it best. This is not the type of game in which one can spend several hours in one sitting and expect to experience vast amounts of action or change. As with life itself, change only occurs over time, and even then, slowly. Change is only evident through the accumulation of experience over time. Whoa. That's deep, man. But it's bullshit! The game demands I play by its schedule. So, what am I gonna do to pass the time? Oh, I guess I'll play this Famicom disc game, which roughly translates to explosive fighter pattern. Why? Because people told me so. They keep feeding me this shit. Let's check it out. No. No way. It's an official Famicom disc game that says the F word. And this was in the 80s. This was before Hong Kong 97. It's an officially released game on a Nintendo console that says fuck. Oh my God, my life is complete. It says fuck. It says fuck. About Seaman.
I regret to inform you that Seaman has passed away.
Oh, so it's game over? I gotta start all over again? Oh, man, I was too busy saying it says fuck. Can I go back a day? Why not?
I'll go into the clock settings. Yeah, I'll just set the clock back.
The time setting of the Dreamcast internal clock does not match the time setting of your Seaman Habitat file.
It doesn't work. The manual says, note that you will be unable to return to a previous stage. Such as with life itself, you may only continue forwards. This isn't life! This is a game! Forwards. We can go forward at least. I'm gonna start over, and this time, I'm gonna keep jumping the clock ahead a day. And that way, I can hopefully play the game faster in one sitting. It sorta works. You still have to spend lots of time waiting for the Gillman to ask you questions, and waiting for various other things to happen. It doesn't cut down on the total amount of time you need to spend, it just makes it so that you can play the game in one long marathon. The daily routines are heat up the tank, turn up the oxygen, feed the seamen, spray the insect cage. Oh right, I didn't explain the insect cage yet. Basically, you have to keep the moisture level up so you can grow Mothra to lay larva eggs to provide food for the seamen.
Did you see the moth emerge from the cocoon? It is quite amazing.
Or fascinating. The controls couldn't be any more tedious. The heater gains momentum the longer you hold the button. When you let it go, it keeps going for a bit, so you have to make sure you don't overshoot it.
Hey, enough with the heater already.
There's no way to turn it back down. It only falls gradually on its own. With the water spray, you have to keep tapping it, but only works at its own pace. Ugh. All right, another round of that. Time to set the clock forward again. All right. Something's not right. I think I'm losing my mind.
Hey, guess what we're doing over here?
Oh, no, please. The seamen are mating, and they felt the need to announce it, to make it known. There they are, staring you right in the face. I didn't even know one of them was female. They both have a male voice. That's not logical. It dies? It got fucked to death?
In general, would you describe yourself as a confident person?
Am I confident in myself? Well,
you don't have to be perfect to still be able to like yourself, so tell me.
It all started with my pet albatross.
The most important thing is that your dad knows how much he means to
you.
I
just feel like nothing matters, you know?
If you manage to glimpse the world through each other's
eyes, keep up with technology.
What will your future be like?
It's a natural result of the world's economy becoming mixed.
No reality independent of observation.
I never thought of it that way.
Human beings are the only animals smart enough to entertain itself in a complex way.
Eventually, Seaman will help you move a rock that drains all the water. He or she or whatever it is will crawl ashore, then spend 5 minutes making these wretched death sounds. Oh my god. Finally it dies, leaves behind eggs that hatch into turd men, suck each other's blood until one remains, grows legs again, and swims ashore until it becomes the Frogman. This thing has an ecosystem more complex than Ridley Scott's Alien. With all seriousness, I know I've been negative, and yes, the game is tedious, mind-numbing, and makes you feel like you're living in purgatory, but it's very creative. It's basically a form of virtual pet game, a pet that happens to be a sarcastic, wise-ass son of a bitch, but also intellectual. It succeeds in making you feel like you're talking to a living being.
I tell you, I exist just as much as you do.
Oh, come on, you're not real.
People, places, and things exist only because you perceive them. When you see me and listen to me, I exist as a part of your consciousness. I become real.
Oh, okay. You do exist. And you're my favorite game.
All hail Sega. Buy another Dreamcast.
What did you say? Is that what this is all about? You've evolved into a Sega mascot? A piece of promotion? Just like the old Sega commercials. How they brainwashed kids with their blast processing. People play this game and get so attached to Seaman that the line between reality and unreality begins to blur. Just like how people are so attached to the internet.
Just don't come to me when you're biologically fused to your computer screen and haven't changed your underwear or talked to a real person in weeks.
That's right. People will all become mindless slaves to the internet. Remember the Sega Channel? Sega was one of the first to offer downloadable gaming. By attaching this device to your Genesis, you were plugged into their network. We're all caught in the spider's web, and the final part of the grand scheme was the evolution of the Dreamcast with Seaman. Sega, sentient electronic global annihilator. It's hell-bent on world domination. Why else would the Sega have tried to overtake such a big corporation as Nintendo with their Genesis Does What Nintendo Don't campaign? Why were the systems named after planets? The Saturn, the canceled Neptune, the Sega was trying to consume the whole galaxy, eventually the universe. And why does Seaman want to know so much about your family?
Ha, my knowledge of you and your family grows ever more complete.
The Sega is trying to consume your identity, to learn all about you so it can become you. The Podfish are coming. They're here already. You're next. You're next. I must destroy it. I'm gonna move the clock so far forward, you're gonna be ancient history again.
It is not necessary for you to lavish quite so much attention on Seaman. I hope that Seaman is not disturbing your everyday routine.
As with life itself, change only occurs over time, and even then,
you must feed me with game requests to keep me going.
Change is only evident through the accumulation of experience over time.
And because I can see you and hear you and... smell you. You exist as part of my consciousness. See ya.
Before, there was board games, and then they made video games, and then they made board games of the video games. So it went from cardboard and plastic to pixels on a screen, back to cardboard and plastic again. Let's see how well some of these video game board game games have turned out. First up is Pac-Man. If you know how Pac-Man's played, then there's not much to say. They translated the video game to physical medium in a pure and faithful way. The famous pellets are represented by these balls which go in his mouth. It works okay. Damn. The main difference is that there's multiple Pac-Men for competitive gameplay. On each player's turn, they control their Pac-Man and also a ghost to chase after the other Pac-Men. If caught, they go back to the starting point. Imagine what it would be like to be trapped for all eternity with two ghosts. The game ends when all the balls are gone. The player to gobble the most balls wins. I do have to say, the Pac-Man pieces are a little strange looking. Even the instructions say, "Move your silly Pac-Man playing piece," as if they were admitting it's stupid. The game isn't perfect for sure, it's just kind of, you know, I guess you could say it's...
I think the proper term you're searching for is, it's a piece of shit! Who'd want to play a board game of Pac-Man when you can play the video game instead?
You mean like that asinine Atari 2600 version where they couldn't even get Pac-Man into a circle shape? It's not great, but at the time, this was a better way to get Pac-Man into the home than that flickering glitchy mess.
Face it, nobody cares about board games.
I prefer to have something physical that you could actually get your hands on. Here's a better example. Pac-Man Magnetic Maze. This version gives you more of that instant gratification, that real-time action you're looking for. It's closer to the video game. You actually use a joystick which wobbles the board around, therefore moving the pieces. The goal is to collect the points which magnetize to Pac-Man's head and bring them back to the start point while avoiding the ghosts or monsters. Why do they refer to the ghosts as monsters?
Because it's garbage! What kind of board game uses a joystick anyway?
Okay, let's try Super Mario Brothers. That's a great action-oriented game with plenty of possibilities. The art style is very much in tune with the video game, but let's see how it plays.
Each player takes turns controlling Mario. That's odd that you all share the same pawn. If you roll red, you move on to the next red space. If you roll yellow, you move on to the next yellow space.
Real fun game. Really beats playing the video game, doesn't it? Don't you just love rolling that die? Roll.
Yeah, it's pretty tedious. You're constantly landing on spaces, potentially covering almost the entire board. Having numbered dice would have made the game much quicker paced. Sure, you can choose to take alternate paths, but the choices of where to go are very limited. There's hardly any strategy involved. Your turn ends when you roll stop, then the other players take control of Mario. But whenever you collect 4 coins, you can trade them in for an extra roll, or an extra life, as the instruction manual calls it. A mushroom gives you 4 coins, but since 4 coins gives you an extra life, couldn't a mushroom just be an extra life?
Yeah, you might have to take some fucking mushrooms to understand this game.
Then there's the hazard cards. Whenever you hit a question mark, you collect another card which you can use on the other player. Basically, what the cards do is spawn enemies for the other players to land on. If they land on an enemy, they lose a life, or in other words, the turn goes back to you. The goal of the game is to be the first player to land on the final space, therefore rescuing the princess.
Well, this is kind of stupid. Now you're talking some sense. Nothing in the game matters. It's all about who gets that final roll.
What's the point of putting hazards down? Just wait for Mario to get near the end, then start playing competitively. By putting down hazards, all you're doing is slowing Mario down and prolonging the game.
It's like trying to play a game of chess by yourself. Everything you do on one side counteracts the other.
Well, this could easily be solved if there were two different playing pieces, like only if there was somebody else besides Mario. Who is that now?
Luigi? Nailed it on the head like a hammer, brother.
Brother, it sucks.
How much does it suck?
It fucking sucks!
Say it like it is!
It's a shitload of fuck!
That's a good one.
Here's one that's okay. It's Super Mario Bros. The Great Ladder Race Game. Here, two players, Mario and Luigi, race to get up and down the ladder without falling off. You have to appreciate the simplicity. I like games that deal with physics.
Yeah, but what does it have to do with Mario? Isn't this exactly what you want with a Mario game? Hanging on fucking ladders?
Well, come to think of it, it should have been based on the ladder finale from It's a Mad, 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 Mad World. But anyway, I think this is pretty good because instead of trying to force the video game into a board game, here, they just made something new.
I'm just trying to look on the positive side. There is no positive side. It's like trying to describe a dog turd that's sitting on a sidewalk. Which side is better? The side that's facing up, drying up in the hot afternoon sun, or the side that's sticking to the cement, staying moist and shitty?
Alright, let's try Legend of Zelda. The art design looks promising enough. The board is colorful, appealing, and represents the labyrinth-style gameplay that we know and love. Well, just like in the Mario game, all the players share Link. They each take turns moving him around. Each room has its own set of colored tiles. When you land on a yellow square, you uncover a tile. If it's a monster, you fight it by rolling the battle dice. If the number of swords rolled is equal or higher than the number of the monster, you win. If the monster has a heart, you get a heart. But if you lose, you lose one of your hearts. If anyone loses all their hearts, the game ends. When you uncover the special item, you can move to the next room. In the very last room lies the Triforce. When somebody gets the Triforce, the game ends, but they don't necessarily win. The winner is the person to have the most hearts when the game is over.
Well, it makes more sense than the Mario game, but it's definitely no Hero Quest or Dragon Strike, because those games were meant to be board games. This was meant to be a video game.
Yeah, I wish I was playing the real Zelda instead. Damn straight. Now you're starting to see the light, Board James? Or should I call you Video James? Here's Street Fighter II, the board game. I guess there was no Street Fighter I game. Oh no, they did it. They took Street Fighter literally.
It's just a bunch of fucking streets! Get it? Street Fighter? They fight on the streets! On the streets!
You're right, it's ass. I'm gonna go play the video game.
Fine. This is a pretty big board anyway. For a video game that's just two people fighting, all it really needed was dice and cards. When you roll the die, you don't count spaces, you count directions on the street. So every time you turn a corner, that's one number on the die. When players meet, they fight by doing what? You guessed it, rolling battle dice. The winner gains a point on their power meter. The higher your meter gets, the more dice you get to roll in battle. First player to get their power meter to the top wins. But then there's M. Bison, who has a countdown meter. If his countdown meter makes it to the end, that means everybody loses. But players can also try fighting M. Bison if they're powerful enough. If someone beats him, that person wins the game.
Wow. Just as much fun as playing the video game.
This is a mess. This whole thing is a mess. What do I need this for? Did I put this together right? Remove the pawn stands, building stands, clips and pegs from underneath the cardboard platform. Separate the clips and twist the pegs off the runner. Discard waste. Discard waste. Tetris? Oh no, you gotta be kidding me! Who makes a board game of Tetris? How do you make a board game of Tetris? That isn't even possible! What am I supposed to do here? Play fucking Tetris on cardboard? Fuck this. Players all simultaneously and randomly pick block shapes out of a box. They place them on the board and arrange them just like you would if you were playing Tetris. If you get a block you don't want, you pass it to the next player. When somebody reaches the top, the game ends. Whoever has the least amount of open spaces wins. So basically you're trying to cover as many spaces as possible in the quickest amount of time. What's the point? I guess it's good for people who don't have electricity but still want to play video games. You could play it on Game Boy with AA batteries. Who needs this shit? Who makes video games into board games? It's all a bunch of circle jerk marketing bullshit. I played some board games out of boredom, but this shit, you gotta be really bored. What were they thinking?
You know who you are. You're a nerd. You'll always be a nerd. A video game nerd.
Goddamn kids, they left me a flaming bag of shit. The Crow City of Angels. It was on PC, PlayStation, and Sega Saturn. And all the same, the PC version was a piece of crap, the PS version was a piece of shit, and the Saturn version was a satanic turd more lethal than 10 tons of Donkey Dookie dropping from a 60-story building.
The Crow was a dark action film based on a comic series. The film takes place the night before Halloween, Mischief Night, or Devil's Night, which is associated with the more destructive version of Mischief Night, which is not so much about petty pranks, but more about vandalism and arson. It's also somewhat related to an older tradition, Guy Fawkes Night, but that's another story. Anyway, The Crow, of course, starred Brandon Lee, Bruce Lee's son. You can't talk about The Crow without mentioning the fact that he was accidentally killed on set by a defective gun blank. Yeah, I have nothing but tragedy to tell today. The plot was about a rock star named Eric Draven. He and his girlfriend are violently killed by a horrible gang. But he's resurrected and seeks his revenge after a crow leads his soul back to the world of the living. Yeah, it sounds weird when you say it fast, but it was a pretty good movie. While not perfect, it was stylized with a gloomy and surreal comic book tone, similar to Tim Burton's Batman. That would be a good time to make a video game, right? No, there were no games based on The Crow. Nada. Diddly fucking squat. Then came the shitty sequel, The Crow, Shitty of Angels. Ho ho! Now it's time to make a game!
Ugh. Alright, let's pop this fucking turd in here.
Loading. Yeah. My ass is loading. Okay. Great opening screen. Take a guess which tiny pixely blob is me. The one in the center that your eyes are immediately drawn to? I'm pushing left and right, and the dude is walking side to side. That would have to be me, right? No. I'm the guy in the bottom right turning in a circle. Just wonderful. Rather than just simply pressing which direction you want to go, check this out. This is how it works. Left and right, turn yourself around in a 360 motion, while up makes you go forward. No matter which direction you or the camera are facing, up is always forward. This isn't the only game like this. Even the first Resident Evil had the same shitty controls. But for The Crow, I would say this is before they figured out how to program video game controls for three dimensions in a good way, but Super Mario 64 was already out. Alright, first enemy in the game, and I can't even figure- Oh, look, he's punching through me. His fist is coming right out my back. If this is what it's going to be like for every enemy we encounter, then we're in for a real nightmare. As the game explicitly warns you, this is your last chance. The game is so bad that it's become self-aware. Look at this ugly, murky mess. I'm sure they were going for a dark, moody atmosphere and all that, but don't you think it's a little too dark? It's almost just a black screen with yellow and red pools of light. Looks like somebody bled and pissed all over the place after smearing the camera lens with their shit after taking a bunch of Pepto-Bismol. Oh, he's badass. Look, here he comes. He's badass. Like a slasher villain. That's actually pretty terrifying. Look at his fucking face. Looks like a melted candle of one of the members of KISS. And there probably do exist KISS candles. But wouldn't that be great if we could hear God of Thunder or something awesome? But instead, listen to this rockin' tune. Yeah, you'll enjoy hearing that for hours. Nah, you won't. That's the perfect soundtrack to go along with walking around in circles in the most depressing bar in existence. This is a place where people go to cut their wrists and drink gasoline. It's hard to even walk a straight line. On top of the clumsy controls that make you feel like you're driving a tank, the camera angles keep changing at the most inconvenient times. It's so disorienting. Sometimes I deliberately walk around the same area just to see if I could figure out where the line is between one camera angle and the next. It's like stepping into a separate reality. Sometimes the camera angle doesn't change at all. You just step outside the boundaries of existence. Where am I? It's as if there's actually a person behind a mixer who has to switch the camera angles, but that person was too busy smoking pot. Oh, dude. Sorry, man. How about this? I'm behind the fucking bar. I guess they completely forgot to even put a camera back there. And there's times when your feet actually get stuck, as if there's an invisible treadmill.
Hey, clown face.
Let's talk about the fight. It's the worst part of the game, which is unfortunately the part you do the most of. You have a few different variations of kicks and punches you can pull off. You can even throw people, but whether or not you hit your mark is all up to chance. You mash buttons and hope for the best. Half the time, your fists and feet go right through your opponents. That is, if you can even face the right direction. This is like Karate Champ, but taken to three dimensions. The whole thing is a fucking clown show. Oh, my God. And the fighting in the cutscene is there just to tease you. Wow, look, they're actually punching and kicking, even blocking, and they're facing right at each other. This is just a reminder of how much better the game could have been. Oh my God. What is he doing? He's pulling her tits. He's pulling her tits. The awful camera angles add so much to the misery. Don't you love it when you're fighting somebody and you end up in a corner somewhere? Could you imagine if this was somebody's first video game? Or if it was even the first video game ever made? I think even then it would have induced vomiting and irritable bowel syndrome. I wonder if Guy Fawkes would have liked this game. After all, it's based on a shitty sequel, so I don't know what I expected. I guess I expected something a little less vaginal. Yeah, I'm running out of adjectives. The controls, needless to say, are delayed. When you have to turn around, get in position, and then pull off an attack, the response time for all that is way too much. By the time that actually happens, you don't even remember what you tried to do. It's as if every time you press the button, that request gets processed in a queue of commands that's always behind. Weapons, if you're even able to pick them up, you can never hit anybody with them. Within those 360 degrees, you have to turn till you're facing in the precise direction, which you'll never have time to do. Fuck! As soon as the enemies have guns, the game is all over with. They always have ammunition, and you never do. In the time it takes to pick up the guns, pick up the ammo, and then try to shoot at them, they already got you. And if you do manage to pull off a few shots, that's all you get is a few shots, and then the ammo runs out. But not them. They come at you with fucking machine guns and drain your life bar instantly. Jeez! Strange that in the movie, the guns can't kill him, but I suppose playing as an invincible, immortal character wouldn't have made for a challenging game. But this is way too challenging, and the challenge isn't about legit gameplay, the challenge is all about trying to outsmart the broken-ass controls. The only way I'm able to glimpse ahead in the game is by using passwords. Even then, as soon as the level starts, the enemies immediately gang up on you. I tried every stage in the game, and none of them I can last more than a minute. I even turned the difficulty down, and still, it's fucking insane! This is the definition of frustrating. Like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde frustrating, and it all leads up to a battle that looks like something out of Hellraiser. Fuck. Shit! God fucking damn it! This game is worse than a Mischief Knight prank. Mischief Knight is throwing toilet paper all over someone's yard. This game is the equivalent of throwing toilet paper after you wiped your ass. It's as refreshing as a horse's anus. Fuck the crawl up its burnt ass. And fuck you, you fucking clown-faced Joker, kiss makeup wearing King Diamond Beetlejuice Alice Cooper Marilyn Manson motherfucker! Yo, nerd, I got a better game for us. Boar James, go away. You don't get a Halloween special. Fuck you, you fucking asshole! Why? I never get a Halloween special! Why is it always gotta be about you? When's it gonna be my turn?
Okay. As soon as Halloween is over, we'll play some plastic and cardboard.
Better late than never.
Seen the movies. You've played the video game. Now, see Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, the game, the movie. Dr. Jekyll, man of science, on the brink of discovery.
Yes?
I'm a bit worried. You're spending too much time with these experiments.
I'm on to something really special. I am. One day, everyone will want to separate the good and evil parts of their personality.
Do whatever you want. Just don't forget the wedding.
Of course. I promise. What could possibly go wrong?
Dr. Jekyll get married?
Like he thinks he's better than the rest of us.
Does he really think he's better than the rest of us?
Fuck! Jekyll!
He came to me and said, good morning.
The nerve.
I hope you have a great day.
The nerve.
And I was like, who are you to tell me what to do?
He's late already.
He is a very slow walker.
He walks with a cane, but it never touches the ground.
Tell me about
it. I just don't even know what he does.
You don't even know him. How can you marry him?
He's got eyeballs and testicles.
Hello, my boy.
What is that you've got there?
The little laddie Billy Pons.
Ah, he's my boy.
He's a good boy.
Oh.
I like him already.
I won't rest until every man, woman, child, an insect is after him.
Ah. Oh, no. Oh. Oh. Oh.
Stop with the huckle and kill Juggle!
Kill the bastard!
Cinemassacre invites you to share the agony of a man who's about to face a dual challenge. Demons. Mr. Hyde battles monsters with his secret weapon, the deadly Psycho Wave. Two worlds struggle for control. Which will triumph, good or evil, Jekyll or Hyde?
Oh! I got you! I got you, you son of a bitch!
Blazing from the pages of Robert Louis Stevenson, the classic tale of horror comes to vivid life.
Oh, fix it!
I'm just trying to go to my wedding!
Kill Jekyll! Kill Jekyll! Kill Jekyll! Kill Jekyll! Kill Jekyll! Kill Jekyll! Kill Jekyll!
Well, Christmas is almost here again, already. The cold weather's kicking in, the snowfall, the ice, it's gonna get below freezing, maybe even sub-zero, which reminds me. Ah yes, Nintendo 64 end labels, the greatest invention ever. When Nintendo drops the ball, the fans pick it up. Here it is, Mortal Kombat Mythologies Sub-Zero. This is one Mortal Kombat game that I have never played before. But how could that be? It was one of my favorite video game franchises. Yeah, in the 90s, Mortal Kombat was the fucking tits. Everybody was obsessed with it. When it came to fighting games, Street Fighter II and Mortal Kombat were as essential as food and water. I'll never forget my first time seeing the original game in the arcades. I distinctly remember catching a glimpse of it between the shoulders of bigger kids crowding around it. I was impressed by the graphics, the realistic human figures, and shocked by the excessive blood and gore. It was awesome. It was one of the games to inspire the rating system. When it came to home consoles, nobody knew what to do. The Genesis version had a code to unlock the blood, while the Super Nintendo version left it out altogether. But starting with Mortal Kombat 2, it was blood for all. How to do the finishing moves and how to unlock secret characters was a daily school bus and lunchtime conversation. You could be the most geeky, socially awkward kid in school, but as soon as you'd show up passing around Mortal Kombat codes, you were the ultimate hero. There was a mystique to these games. It was all about secrets and rumors, such as a swearing code and a nude code. One time somebody printed out a move list which they got from connecting their computer to their telephone line. It was like science fiction shit, but it turned out to be an early form of something even bigger than life itself, called the internet. As I remember it, the mid-90s was the peak of Mortal Kombat fever, which led up to Mortal Kombat Trilogy in 96. It combined everything you wanted from the first three games. With new generation game consoles like PlayStation and N64, the games were getting closer to arcade quality, and that's what we all wanted, to be able to play the arcades in our own home. And then in 97 came Mythologies Sub-Zero. So why haven't I played this one before? Could it be that I was distracted by Mortal Kombat 4, which came out close to the same time? Or was it because I heard that it was very different from all the other games? All these years, I've been trying to get around to playing it, because anything Mortal Kombat related, you gotta play it. It can't be that bad, right? Oh, wait, what the fuck? God! Okay, you have to press B to turn around. In all the other Mortal Kombat games, you automatically face your opponent, but here, every time you jump to the other side, it's one extra button you gotta press. This is like Karate Champ bullshit. I can understand why this might be necessary, because unlike other Mortal Kombat games where you fight your opponents one at a time, here, you're fighting multiple enemies, so if you find yourself in between two of them, you might need to turn around. Sometimes, it turns automatically. Yeah, you never know. So after you jump, you'll hit the button, only to find that you turned yourself the wrong way. Alright, well, that ruins the whole game. Game sucks. Case closed. Should I just end the video right now? Or could the game get even worse? Obviously, you play as Sub-Zero. I suppose if the game caught on, they would have made a whole mythology series starring all the different characters, and I think that is what they were intending. Well, I'm glad they didn't quit their day job. The day job being real Mortal Kombat. There are some RPG elements. When you fight enemies, you earn experience points, gain inventory, and learn special moves, like Sub-Zero's trademark ice projectile. But being so familiar with the other Mortal Kombat games, it comes off as more of a tease that you don't already have it from the start.
Ah! Now they're gonna start doing that shit!
Alright, wait for it. Wait for it.
Ah!
Now I'm on a ledge. What do I do here? Jump? Of course not. Oh, you just drop down and bounce off the awning. Yeah, okay. Your mother!
Oh God, there's too many guys!
What? More of these? Okay, okay, easy does it.
Get the fuck out of my way!
Yeah, did you see that? I fucking squashed that bitch!
Fuck!
Run!
Ooh!
Okay, strategy. Run and stop.
Nope.
Can't run, can't walk, can't fucking do anything! After you make it through, by some miracle, you'll fight Scorpion. It's a one-on-one battle and looks just like traditional Mortal Kombat. It looks like it, but trust me, it doesn't feel like it at all. If only you knew. If only you were the one holding the controller right now, you'd know exactly what I mean. Here, take it. Yeah, I know. You would if you could, but trust me, don't. If I was jumping off a bridge, would you do it too? Nah, this is jumping off a bridge. And I'm not happy. Afterwards, you get a cutscene. This is where I should mention that the game was also on PlayStation. It's very similar, but the most noteworthy difference is that on the N64, the cutscenes are just still images and text, but with the PlayStation version, since it was a CD-based console, it was able to have full motion video and audio.
I am Scorpion. You killed me in cold blood.
Just stick to Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Okay, what the hell am I supposed to do here? The fuck? Oh jeez, I just outran the screen. Gotta give some credit for the 3D or 2.5D backgrounds. Another basic problem is that to jump, you press up. In any typical Mortal Kombat game or any tournament fighter, that's normal. But in a platforming jumping game, up is fucked up. Sometimes you intend to step back, but your thumb slides across up and you jump by accident. The entire level 2 is all about hopping these platforms. Come on, you son of a bitch! Ah, oh, fuck! Ugh, get out of my way, I'm just trying to... Oh, okay. That makes it easier. For many of these jumps, you have to wait to ride the wind current. Or not. Okay, should I jump then? Ugh. Sometimes the wind comes right away, but other times you have to wait for it. And then there's times when you have to jump blindly, a leap of faith. And then there's times when I don't even know. As if that's not bad enough, then you have to start jumping on these spoons. You don't have much control over your jumps. It's always the same arch from wherever you last stood. Once you're in the air, there's nothing else you can do. Even when you do land on the spoons, you don't really land on them. You sort of magnetize to them. And I love how abruptly the continue screen appears. Watch this. Wow. They didn't waste any time. Unlike Symphony of the Night, where it takes like 3 fucking hours! You'll be busy fighting, and then all of a sudden this screen comes up and you might accidentally hit no. But it doesn't matter anyway, because I've been using passwords to skip ahead, and even then, the game is impossible. It's one cheap death trap after another. Oh, come on! That is low. And it's a real fair fight when there's all this shit on the screen. Foreground obstructions, real classy. Also, it's one of those where the fuck do I go type of games. Yeah, you know, the kind that make you say, where the fuck do I go? How about down here? Nope, another dead end. Okay, what do I do now? What? Oh! I hate this! Where do I jump? Where do I jump? I can't kick this guy. I can't jump. The jump kick never fails like this. Ah! Fuck! Shit! Fuck! I didn't know there was a transformer in the game. It's Blaster. No wonder I haven't played this one before! This is anal sauce!
Finish him. Fatality.
Welcome to the Art Gallery. Here, we'll be looking at video game cover art. There's a saying, don't judge a book by its cover, which is true. Sometimes the cover does not accurately represent the work that is inside. However, the cover is a work of art in itself, and it's the first thing you see. It was especially important in the old days because we didn't have the internet to tell us what the game was like. The cover had to tell us everything. So it's about time we give game cover art the attention it's due. Usually we sit down and play the actual games to review them in depth, and that's all fine, we will do that. You will see a new nerd episode in time for Christmas. But since it's the season of giving, I'll be giving you a little something extra. Every day until Christmas, we'll be observing some of the most exquisitely bad works of art from game history. Pro Wrestling for the Sega Master System. Absolutely stunning. This work is all about irony, in the sense that it uses the term pro for professional, yet goes for an amateurish style. The background grid paper is reminiscent of the graph paper used in school for math and geometry. Students always doodle on that paper, right? And I don't mean they doodle on it, they scribble on it, okay? Anyway. It looks like something a bored student would draw during class when they're supposed to be doing their work. The most striking thing about the cover is the wrestler who has no head, yet is doing a chokehold on a head. Is it his own head or somebody else's? Whatever the case, it's a very non-traditional wrestling move. Once again, it's ironic that the cover is so traditional, with the same font and background as other Sega Master System games. They all have a uniform look, but this wrestler, who stands outside the corner of the game box, his method goes literally off the grid. Let's assume he is wrestling his own head. It's body versus head. It depicts the internal struggle of brains against bronze. The wrestler, who develops his muscle over mind, shows that muscle is winning the battle. And after all, the term professional wrestling implies the staged form of wrestling to entertain at the audience's suspension of disbelief. Can we suspend our disbelief? Or does this cover make no fucking sense? Mega Man for NES. Splendid. This is what you call a work of fine art. This is the expression of an artist's nightmare as he finds himself stranded in a homemade mustard and blue spacesuit surrounded by radioactive asses in tropical sci-fi land. The dollar store brand colored pencil art style is meant to give the sense of the childish feeling of pre-adolescent fears and tension. And that's why they held an art contest in Nintendo Power magazines for kids to submit their own designs, and then they picked the winner. But that's not true, I just made that up. What actually happened was they picked the loser. You have this proportionally incorrect and aesthetically awful human figure that shrunk down to a minor detached element in the overall composition, framed by rounded corners, to be framed within glowing neon grids, to be framed within the enclosing canvas. If you even have a chance to look at what's going on, you'll see Mega Man has no neck and is wearing shoulder pads as if to deliberately hide his head like a turtle. He's cowardly shrinking into his own suit, as you can see by the wrinkly, oversized sleeves. The way his body is like leaning is kind of like he's doing a dance, like, hey, look at me, I'm hip, I'm cool, check me out. Look at that tired, weepy, pathetic face, which is no more intimidating than the way he's holding his gun. You're looking down the barrel, yet he's pointing the gun to the side. And wait, a gun? Doesn't Mega Man have an arm cannon? Oh, never mind, that's just in case you ever happen to have played the game before. You know, Mega Man, whoever played Mega Man. Certainly not the people who designed the cover. Well, for Mega Man 2, they got a better artist and apparently gave them much more time. But why is Mega Man still holding a gun? And why is his foot turned like he broke his ankle? Look at Crash Man giving a lap dance to Dr. Light. Look at him feeling up that thigh. And what about the European Mega Man 2? What is going on there? Is that his arm? Or a hovering bowling pin? Or, I don't know, some kind of vaginal ultrasound thing. In Mega Man 3, he's blasting a robot right in the crotch. He's smiling and looking at, he's looking right at the crotch, like he knows what he's doing. In Mega Man 4, he's jumping off a cliff while Pharaoh Man is standing on top of the fortress. On top of the fortress! By the time they got to Mega Man 9, which was a downloadable game that didn't even need a cover, they were like, yeah, we get it. It's a joke now. Ha ha. Shatterhand for NES. Marvelous. It's a beautiful portrait of a man who just felt the need to smash his fist into the game's own title. He's breaking his hand on the word hand. How profound. But he's not really hitting it dead on. He is perhaps punching at something else, and his knuckles just happened to graze it. It was an accident. He can't see with those ultra-dark sunglasses on, but he only broke off part of the H, so it's all good. People question what the Mona Lisa is smiling at. But I wonder, what is the Shatterhand Man punching at? Or could it be that he's not really punching at all? Notice the way his arm is bent. It's too relaxed to be a punch. I think he's giving you a bro fist bump. His expression seems to say, "Sup, man!" With the exaggerated perspective of the fist in the foreground, the detail should be more focused, more present, more realistic than the descending planes. But instead, the fist is as unnatural as possible, with odd folds that resemble foreskin on a penis. And did I mention the biomechanical skeletal structure underneath the skin? No? Well, that's because you don't see it at first, because it's almost hidden behind the bulky text. And only one knuckle is hitting the letter, yet two knuckles have damaged flesh. It begs the question, what did he punch the first time? To piece together the whole story, I'm gonna look into the background. My guess is that's supposed to be the Empire State Building. New York City. That's a real fucking place. You can't be a pussy to live there. But this guy just couldn't take it. So bam! Fist flying! Shattering as it hits the fourth wall reality! So what's with the Terminator thing going on? I think it represents man and machine. Specifically, humanity's dependence on technology and tools. The hand as man's biological inherent machine. The hand to do man's dirty work. Which reminds me. Whoever made this cover was jerking off!
Action Fighter for the illustrious Sega Master System. A masterpiece, undoubtedly. Let's begin with the title. Action Fighter tells you everything you need to know. Action suggests battles, shootouts, vehicle chases, and explosions. The single word action encompasses everything we expect in a game on the primitive subconscious level. Fighter, what do you know? A generalization of more of the same. Action implies fighting, fighter implies action. No two words in the history of civilization have so eloquently overstated one another. There's no question of what kind of fighter this is. Not an idle, casual, go-with-the-flow kind of fighter. Could this game by any chance be some kind of puzzle game or video poker? No! Action Fighter, damn it! Just to make sure, without any doubt, you know what it is. Boom! Action Fighter! It hits its mark more effectively than a cow pissing on a flat rock. It's well worthy of the trademark. That's right, patent that shit. It's so brilliant, you wouldn't want anybody stealing that name. This isn't just any cartridge, it's the Mega cartridge, also trademarked. Notice how the G droops down and touches the Mega. That's class. Look how the background grid enhances the obviousness of the condensed kerning. And then there's an image on the cover too, right? Oh yeah, that's it. It's down there. It occupies less than a quarter space of the overall canvas. Nothing suggests action and fighting more than a magnifying glass on a highway. This is a special magnifying glass that doesn't make things larger. Instead, it forces the perspective into a Hitchcock vertigo effect. Is this really an action game or some kind of detective game? It seems the detective is using the magnifying glass while driving. Rather than shutting down the street and getting up close to survey the area, this detective is gonna fly right through, emphasizing the importance of high-speed action over tedious scrutiny. The lack of details on the buildings intensifies the feeling of tunnel vision, to be focused on one point, rushing to a particular goal, a clue. One vital clue that we so eagerly wish to have. The cover leaves you in suspense. What is the clue? Is there a clue? Did the human being who made this have any clue? Shingen the Ruler on NES. Here we have a decently rendered male face, which seems to disappear into an image of an army riding on horses. It's as if a cloud of less detailed, more generic art floated in front of him. Why would this be so important that it needs to intrude on the focal character? It's as if the background took a bite out of the side of his face. I believe it symbolizes the conformity to a larger society of socioeconomic repression. It should be noted that sometimes the art on the box is different than the art on the game cartridge. On the cartridge, he's obscured even more by the goddamn instructions! Why is this on the cartridge? Seems like somebody really hated that artwork and wanted to do everything they could to cover it up. Or maybe they'd never seen a video game before. The instructions come with the game! You know, on paper! In a little booklet! You don't need it on the cartridge. Of course, it's not the full, detailed instructions, but they sure fit as much as they could. Just for a quick reference, in case you're playing the game and you either lost the instructions, or you find it easier to look at the cartridge while you're playing the cartridge. And this would only work in a top loader. If you had the original NES model, you wouldn't even see the fucking cartridge. Maybe it's meant to be read like some kind of art house poetry. Yield. Money. Disaster. Product. Yeah, this product was a disaster that you should yield before spending money. Shingen seems to be peeking out from the cluttered mess of periodic table-like frames of clinical information as if to say, hey, it's me. Me. Look at me. Look at me! This is horseshit. I can't even pretend. Does this make you want to play the game? Was it so complicated they had to put the rules on the cover? Is it because the game is called Shingen the Ruler? They thought it must have the rules? I'm surprised they didn't put an image of a measuring ruler on it. Well, we're gonna need to find the longest tape measure in existence because I didn't know they stacked shit this high! Phalanx or Phalanx for Super Nintendo. Well, the game is a 2D space shooter. It says, plain as day, the hyperspeed shootout in space. Many would say this cover has nothing to do with the game.
But of course it does. There's a spaceship. See? They got it in there. That little magic Disney Tinkerbell sparkle whizzing by way, way, way back there in the background. There's no getting around it. The main focus is an old man playing a banjo. Because isn't that the first thing you think of when you think of a hyperspeed shootout in space? But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe this guy is in the game. Yeah, in fact, he's a major part of the game. You just never unlocked that part yet. This is a mall Santa Claus. This is what he does the rest of the year. He's sitting on his porch, playing his banjo. He's been drinking a lot of moonshine. So he fantasizes and pictures himself flying a spaceship, shooting aliens, perhaps a projection of his deep-rooted racism against anyone or anything foreign. Or he's just a jolly old drunk playing a song about a hyperspeed shootout in space. I wonder if the actual man in the photo knew how to play the banjo. Was he just posing with it? Or could he have actually been playing something when this picture was taken?
What am I doing here, motherfucker? Super Nintendo, fuck is that?
Had this cover looked anything like it was supposed to, it wouldn't have been as interesting. There's thousands of generic space shooters out there, so this was an unconventional, yet ingenious way to make it stand out from the rest. It worked, because after all these years, we're still talking about it. This is the North American version of the cover. In all other parts of the world, it actually focused on the spaceship, which looked like, well, this version wasn't phalanx, it was phallus. Snow White, for PlayStation 2. This is terrifying. This isn't Snow White. This is more like evil porcelain dolls come to life. That should be a horror film by Full Moon, as evidenced by the full moon in the background. This is the stuff nightmares are made of. This will haunt your dreams for eternity.
We will tear your soul apart. Your suffering will be legendary in hell. Eat the fucking apple.
Phoenix Games also made this scary-looking Pinocchio game. I guess they specialized in fucked-up fairy tale covers frightening young children. Somebody didn't understand the idea of cover art. It doesn't have to look like the shitty in-game graphics. And am I reading this correctly? Does it say Snow White and the Seven Clever Boys? I thought it was the Seven Dwarves. Were they trying to differentiate it from the Disney film to avoid a lawsuit? Well, it was originally from Grimm's Fairy Tales, so if they're gonna avoid the name, what about the likeness? It obviously looks like the Disney characters, although twisted, fucked up versions. And are they seven boys? Really? Boys? Or more like old men? Besides, I only see four. Where's the other three? Well, there's three trees. Maybe the witch turned them into trees. Or perhaps the trees are a representation of humanity's dying relationship with nature. The game is rated 3 and up. I think that means these demonic fuckers need to take three more souls. Oh no.
Ah, get me out of here.
New York for NES. Oh, action in New York. Action In looks like it was written with a quill pen. Is that the type of font you'd see on the cover of a science fiction action game, or in a line of text from the Declaration of Independence? It's hardly noticeable, but New York is printed so big and clear, just so you know where this game takes place. It reminds me of that game Alien Tiger Meteor Massacre in Middletown, New Jersey. Anyway, that's some banner, like a bumper sticker graphic, with the Statue of Liberty in the center with a big halo or Nova Blast around it. This is a nice graphic. For a t-shirt or a hat. This is like something you'd see in a gift shop. This is the perfect postcard to promote New York City, because nothing says New York more than a man screaming point blank at a robot. I tell you, crazy shit happens in New York City. People screaming at robots, a man shattering his fist against the fabric of space and time. Maybe that robot is the Shatterhand Man after he finished punching all the flesh from his body. The man's face radiates with anger, beaming with expression while the robot stares back at him with a flat, featureless face like a metal trash can. Look at the intensity, the raw emotion, so powerful that it harnesses the lightning. The lightning portrays nature, the only thing that comes between man and machine. It splits the contrast between the imperfect, emotionally driven human being and the unflinching synthetic creation of his own design. The robot represents technology. The man represents humanity's frustration yet unwillingness to live without technology. This does not look like a man who is in combat in a science fiction world. This looks like a man who is mad because his iPhone froze. The man is clearly not ready to attack the robot. Wouldn't his arms be up? How did he get so close before raising his arms to fight? That's because he has no intention to destroy it. He just wants it to do what it's supposed to, but the machine doesn't care. It looks like the robot has just shot a laser from its eyebrows, and we just happened to catch this image the very instant before it blasted the man right through his eyeballs, splattering his brains all over the place. If only he had his laser reflectant visor down. Dumb shit. By the way, the game is a 2D space shooter, the European version of a game called SCAT. It's the same game, only the title is different. SCAT stands for Special Cybernetic Attack Team, but the word SCAT actually means animal shit. Rallogump, an obscure DOS game from the 90s. Well, it's cute. In an infantile way. It's like a child exploring the world for the first time. This child dreams of flying like Superman while wearing a weird hat. Notice the bird-like creature devoid of wings, but the human also devoid of wings is the one who manages to fly. It depicts the freedom of one's own imagination, of ambition to defy all implausibilities. Below, the ground is cross-sectioned out so we can see the fish, with the lack of imagination, being trapped in his own boundaries. The eye on a silver pedestal that sees the world through the child's vision. The only way to see true magnificence is to open your eye big and wide. Behind the mountain, the most terrifying part of the whole image, a scary face that came loose from a totem pole. The creature of nightmares. But the kid, who is in control of his dreams, has the monster barricaded behind the mountains, locked away. As seen by the keyhole, but with no key in sight, the nightmare is effectively locked away. Or it's somebody who took a lot of drugs. Well, what kind of cover is this? Rallo Gump? What is a Gump? Like Forrest Gump or the Gump from the Oz books? This is one of few covers where the artist put their name on it. No. And a free game comes with it, just in case Rallo Gump doesn't catch on. Ghost Lion for NES. It's medieval aerobics time. The tights, the sword, the jewels, the Egyptian snake armband, the wild golden hair going past her ass, the oversized sleeveless shirt that looks like she borrowed it from Arnold Schwarzenegger. You know what? This is awesome. I want to see somebody cosplay as the Ghost Lion girl. This is an 80s metal album cover. There's no doubt about it. But at the last minute, they decide to turn it into an NES game instead. I want to hear the band Ghost Lion. There was an 80s band called Lion who did the Transformers movie theme song. There was also White Lion. And apparently there is or was a band called Ghost Lion, according to MySpace. So what about the lion? Why is it behind the mountains? Is it giant? It doesn't look like any of these elements exist in the same place. Notice how three-dimensionally detailed the girl is compared to the flatness of the lion and the pink background plane. I think that's all part of a cardboard cutout, and she's posing in front of it. Kind of like one of those promotional movie theater backdrops you can get a picture with. She sees the ghost lion, thinks it's so funny, she gets a picture with it, but she happens to be cosplaying as something unrelated. That's exactly what's happening. Why else would she be smiling and looking right at the camera? If she was really going into battle, she'd look much more serious. But the one part that bothers me is that you don't see the whole sword. It takes your eyes off the composition, like she's poking at something. What is happening? Is she stabbing somebody? Is that why she has that devilish grin? There's no question what decade this is. This is the 80s. But you want to know a little surprise? The game came out in 92. But could you imagine if she was wearing flannel and baggy jeans? That would look stupid. Eliminator Boat Duel for NES. Yeah.
Here's what I think happened. They hired somebody to do the cover. They told them the game is called Eliminator Boat Duel. So naturally, the cover gets finished at the last minute. They take one look and go, we said Eliminator Boat Duel. This is just two people riding on a fucking boat, but there was no time to redo it. But they had to do something quick to make it more exciting. With less than an hour to send it out to the printers, the quickest solution was to paste on these flags, just so you know there's some kind of race going on, to add neon streaks to the back of the boat to emphasize speed, to add this cheap splashing whirlpool effect, and to change the color of the water to bright glowing pink, except that part they missed. Before, it would have looked like two people leisurely riding a boat. Now, it looks like two people leisurely riding a boat on an alien planet. Instead of all these added effects, it might have been easier to just change the name to Vacation Boat Ride. If you look closely at the woman's hair, I don't think it's hair. I think it's a surfboard and she's leaning behind it. What's with the glowing mountain peaks? Are those supposed to be sunsets? Two sunsets? It is an alien world. Maybe in the same solar system as Tatooine. Or is this what the Earth looks like after Electro Brain zaps all your brain cells? Just looking at it, it's burning my eyes! Get it off the screen! The European cover was much better. Absurd, yes, but it looks more like a boat duel. Clearly a race is going on since there's actually more than one boat, even though the guy and the girl are still relaxed. But that's because they're so good at winning. This is Mr. and Mrs. Perfect. How can I not mention the giant magnificent breasts? God damn! And they came so close to being covered by the Nintendo seal of quality. Somebody said, make sure to move that down a little. Imagine seeing that on a game when you're 5 years old. In the US, we definitely got the shittier end of the deal for this one. Even the end label couldn't spell Eliminator. Eliminator. This is Street Hockey 95 for Super Nintendo. So let me guess. They didn't know if it was going to be a fighting game or a hockey game, so they got Lil Jon and asked him, and he said, "What?" So they went with a font and color scheme to imitate Street Fighter and asked him to do an impossible levitating kick, and then he said, "Okay!" But okay wasn't good enough, so they added hockey elements, and then he said, "Yeah!" This is like MTV regurgitated all over a Super Nintendo box. I don't get any of this. What's with the Barbie doll girl? That mask he's wearing? That mean dog on the cover? Just to prepare you. Warning, this game is badass. Woof, woof. There's nothing correct about any of the sizes. Is the girl small? Is the alley enormous? Is the man giant? Is that his shadow? Why doesn't the girl have a shadow? Why was she pasted in last minute? And for a game about hockey, there's very little hockey equipment on the cover. That stick he's holding is awkwardly turned, so it might as well be a canoe paddle. I like the way he's pointing at you as if saying, yeah, you want to play this. You know you do. You know you're going to be coming back for Street Hockey 96 and 97, which never happened. Although there were other street sports games like Jam It. Yeah, I'll tell you where you can jam it. The game used the multiplayer adapter, Hudson's Super Multitap. Just in case you'd ever want to play Street Hockey 95 with four people at a time, as soon as anybody sees that cover, they go, oh, okay, that's fine. Irritating stick for PlayStation. Irritating stick? Who puts the word irritating in the title of a video game? Does that make you want to play it? I don't even know what kind of game it is, but I don't care. I'd rather go out in the woods and play with an actual stick. Who buys a game called Stick when you can get sticks for free? But that bright, bold font tries to sell it the best it can, like this is going to be the most exciting thing you'll ever see. See it for the thrill of a lifetime, one night only, Irritating Stick! The comic-style zapping effect seems like it desperately wants to emphasize how irritating this stick is. As soon as you touch something with this stick, zap! It's so obnoxious, it fills the entire background. There's no room for any other artwork. It's all about the electric force of this horrible stick. The original game was similar to Operation or the Wire Loop game where you need to avoid touching anything or else you get an electric zap. But the word irritating doesn't describe it too well. It's just a bad choice of word, kind of like when Nintendo had a console called Revolution and they changed the name to Wii. It's not even like a sword or a spear. Instead, a cheap plastic lightsaber, you know, the kind that light up, except this one hasn't even been lit. Yeah, the batteries are dead. Moving on to the hands, it looks like the crappy in-game graphics of the time. Did they know that on the cover to the game you're allowed to make the artwork more realistic? I guess it doesn't matter when you have a stick that's so irritating it emits lightning. It begs attention, and I've given it. Crackout for NES. This is what happens when you smoke too much crack. This is clearly nothing more than a bad drug trip, or it's just a bad ripoff of the game Fast Food, or it's just the Twizzler's mouth making every possible appearance it could in the 80s. Your eyes have no room to rest on this cover. The way it's tilted, I can't look at it without going like this. It gives you a dizzying effect. It feels like you're flying into its world, rushing into the simple one-point perspective as the objects on the receding planes come whizzing towards you. Eyeballs, teeth, skulls, gloppy drops of mustache bubbles, neon cannonballs bouncing off the walls. This cover screams, "What the fuck?" God damn, help me out here. What's going on? This cover is so intense. On the cartridge, they had to cut off the skull, just to give us a little break. Yet the alternate placement of the Nintendo Seal of Quality allows us to see the green guy popping up from the hole in the floor. He looks so frightened. See? Even he couldn't take it. Where in the universe or multiverse would a place like this ever occur? Well, if you don't dismiss all possibilities, then just for the sake of existence, whoa! A brick tunnel full of baby blocks flying out from the far reaches of space. It has no beginning and no end. An infinite zooming chaos. But if you look far into the background, that tiny white space, is that a wall? Are we going to smack into it like a bird hitting a plane? Or is that an open doorway, the light at the end of the tunnel, a white purgatory? Could you imagine going from one extreme to the next? First, it's overstimulation, and then complete sensory deprivation. This artwork is a metaphor for life. It's crazy, but then one day, it's all gone. Cock-in for Commodore 64. The game is called Cock-in. Even though it involves chickens and has an alternate title, Chicken Chase, some whack job decided to call it Cock-in. And instead of chickens on the cover, people wearing chicken hats, dressed like ragdolls with lifeless dummy faces. The dude's holding a shark on a string that bites her elbow while she hands him a testicle. Really, what else is it supposed to be? An egg? Then why is it flesh-colored? The cover is extremely rare. No high-quality image of it exists. So at first, I thought he had a nutsack on his chest. Until I realized the second testicle is just the negative space between her fingers. The color blends in with his chest. How hard was it to make an egg white? And it's not perfectly oval either. It's a testicle. You know that expression, "I'd give my left nut"? That's what's happening. In the actual game, you're a rooster chasing hens around to mate with them. Chase the chickens. What are you, Rocky? The intricate folds makes the woman's shirt seem realistic, but the body is so lifeless. It's as if they put a real shirt on a mannequin body. She has no collarbones and a long neck. Yeah, but what about the testicle? How could you talk about something else? It's right in the middle. The whole composition draws your attention to it. In between the man's fist, the triangle shape she's making with her arms, the heads both leaning to the side, and right in the center, look at the gonad, the shark, the cockheads, the gonad. Now, find out how they all relate. Because your guess is as good as mine. Treasure Master for NES. This is a surreal stream of consciousness that represents sensory overload to the video game-brained kid of the 80s. This is his fantasy. Everything awesome and rad that ever existed all comes to the party. There's covers where the artist didn't have enough time, but I think this is one instance where the artist might have had too much time. We gotta sell the game. What do we do? Sharks are popular. Put a fucking shark on there. How about submarines and spaceships? Yeah, that's good. What about robots? Gotta have a robot and a spider on a circuit board. Yeah, do that. Pyramids, mushrooms, bubbles, a Transformers grid pattern, space. What about treasures? Fuck it. Just have a kid with sunglasses and zebra patches, giving thumbs up, smiling at the consumer, saying, yeah, you like all this shit. The kid is just as happy as the artist. Nobody's ever made such an amazing box art. It's win all the way around. It depicts narcissism. The kid is looking at you like, yo, I'm so cool. He is the treasure master. Or perhaps he's calling out to you in desperation, trapped in some kind of floating rectangle, sort of like the General Zod prison thing from Superman 2. The game was created for a contest by MTV in which gamers would put in a code, they'd complete the game, and then they'd get a number to call in and win prizes. Which makes sense because this looks like something MTV barfed up. You know, Castlevania 3 also had a contest. Win a trip to Dracula's castle. Yes, Dracula's real castle. I bet that's where the kid who won the Treasure Master grand prize ended up, in Dracula's dungeon being tortured for all eternity. Carnage Rally for Game Boy Advance. Good God. There are no two elements in this picture that belong together. It's a mishmash. The computer-generated title, the blurred image of a car, a blue-haired screaming maniac photoshopped in front of it. I don't even know where to start. What is Carnage? Why is the letter R singled out? The N could have just as well sprouted the flags. Why is the car so blurred that you can hardly tell what it is? Why is the man so sloppily cut out? And why is he leaning at such an awkward angle? Perhaps the car is ramming into the side of his head. What was the purpose of dyeing his hair, or excuse me, photoshopping his hair blue? Is this some sophomoric acting or what? I've heard the game itself is actually pretty good, but who'd want to play it based on the cover? If it's a game about racing, show us the car! Not some goofy guy who just made the most epic photobomb in history. Let's say I did buy the game based on the cover. I'd be disappointed if he wasn't the main star. I don't want to race cars, I want to be the blue hair guy who runs around the track and goes, "Hurr!" Maybe he's a former racer, but he never achieved success, so he's now depressed and losing his mind. So he dyes his hair blue, he shows up at the raceway, and starts making a total mockery of the profession. Maybe that's what he does every day. They're used to him. Yep, that's him again, clowning around. Just carry on with the race. Don't draw attention. That's what he wants. Just ignore him. Hell Fighter for NES. Is that a title or what? Hell Fighter. I like the way the title's zooming into the foreground, glistening like shiny steel. That's the way you do it. Without much else to look at besides a plain blue background, let's get straight to the point. It's simply a naked man holding a skull. Has this guy been doing some bodybuilding or what? He's so buff that his muscles take on alien features. Look how pointy his knee is. And his hand completely disappears into the light aura of the skull. The skull is not very pronounced. The glow needs more transparency so you can make it out. Why is he holding a skull anyway? He's staring at it like, yeah, I like death. The crotch is bulging out from the tiny underwear, which is conveniently covered by the text oval. Somebody clearly looked at it and said, we can't show that, cover it up. Which makes me wonder, has anyone seen the original art? Even the Japanese version blocked out the crotch. The whole world was saying, hey man, put on some damn pants. The sword looks like it's sticking in his ass. He has no belt, nothing to strap the sword onto, unless you buy that it's hanging on the back of his thong. It's in his ass! You heard a sword in the stone? This is sword in the ass! He shits green rocks. What do you expect? The guy's so macho, all he eats is stones and minerals. He shits them out, and the dragon's licking at him like yum yum. Ugh, God. Hellfighter. Looks like hell to me. Scrapyard Dog for the Atari 7800. What's with the
nose? What's with the nose? Who cares about the dog? Look at the nose. What was the point? Everything else is pretty sound, but some wacky artist decided to give him a huge nose, just for the hell of it. He is the star, never mind that it's called Scrapyard Dog. Maybe he's the dog. The idea of faces inside of circles is pretty funny when you think about it. Like, here's the circle, and then somebody's meant to pop their head up into it. We were only meant to see the dog. He was supposed to lift his pet dog up in there, but he came up too at the last minute. And that's the image, and there's nothing we can do about it. Maybe it's meant to be a freak show. The circus colors support that. I like how the dog is sort of looking at the nose, like the dog isn't sure about it. And the man isn't really looking at the dog. His eye line is going off somewhere else, like he's talking to somebody. I can't be in the picture? Or he's talking to the dog, you know, keeping it comfortable for the picture.
Hey, Peabody, Peabody, that's a good boy.
People say that pets sometimes look like their owners. Well, if the dog had his nose or he had the dog's ears, it would be pretty crazy. This is junk. What do you expect with a game called Scrapyard Dog? Rollerblade Racer for NES. Rollerblades. Radical. Radiant. Blazing colors. That's the 80s. That's what it was all about. All those who lived it, trust us. We can tell you. That chalk pattern background, that's what the world actually looked like back then. You'd be rollerblading with your flat top hair and your rat tail in the back, listening to Michael Jackson on your Walkman, slapping high fives with Voltron. You'd be eating your Mr. T cereal and Pee Wee Herman would come by and play Pac-Man with us. It happened all the time. It was so crazy, there wasn't even such a thing as temperature. No, the man's wearing a sleeveless shirt while the girl is bundled up like it's the middle of winter. Don't judge a cartridge by its box. Check this out. The cartridge has no background. I suppose the box was finished last. All it is a solid hot pink. Let me tell you, in the 80s, that color was the most bodacious thing. You wanted hot pink. Seriously, our eyes were attracted to how bright it was. Look at it, the way it burns into your retina. That's awesome. Give me more. Nowadays, most people seem to associate pink with feminine, but back then, it had nothing to do with that. Didn't matter if you were boy or girl. Hot pink, damn it! It's so vibrant that it's actually bleeding into the graphics. The labels on cartridges can fade a little, so imagine how pink it was when the game was new. It was so fucking pink, it was made to last the ages. The contrast on the people is boosted so much that they blend together. At first glance, it looks like both bodies have merged into an eight-legged creature. Eight legs? Eight decades? The 80s! This game is the living embodiment of the 80s. Well, the game came out in 93. Well, fuck everything I just said. Here's a hot pink screen for you to look at. Yeah, you like that. Yeah, stare at it long enough, you'll grow a mullet. Killer Kong for the ZX Spectrum. In America, we would say letter ZX. But Killer Kong, I can't look at it. How could you look at that grinning gorilla without losing your shit? The mystery of the Mona Lisa's subtle smile is nothing compared to this. What is this gorilla smiling about? Like he or she, probably she because of the breasts, knows something that you don't. But this is Killer Kong, so maybe this motherfucker's thinking about killing you. The way it meets your stare is unsettling. It feels as if it is actually looking at you, and the moment you look away, it's gonna lunge out of the cover and show you exactly what it means by Killer Kong. It kinda looks like one of those public domain VHS tapes, or like somebody was trying to release King Kong on VHS, but they didn't have the proper rights, so they had to make this half-ass cover. Notice how the edges of the gorilla are so rough, so it's almost being swallowed by the background. It burns into your eyes and invokes visions of cotton candy bubblegum dreams, but it's all a trick. This game is very rare, so it's hard to get a good image of it. I wish I could tell what that round thing is on the eye. It looks sort of like a monocle. This is a high fashionable gorilla who likes to examine things up close, particularly your innards. The game itself is a clone of Donkey Kong, and there were many Donkey Kong copycats floating around at the time. That's what happens. Somebody makes a successful game, and then others copy. Monkey see, monkey do. You see the monkey, and the monkey see you. Hammer and Harry for NES, a symbol of testosterone. This guy is Mr. Macho right here. This is the manliest man ever. My cock is so hard! What's with the Rambo headband and his eye that's off-center? Weird. Look at him screaming out the side of his mouth like Sylvester Stallone. On the cartridge, it looks like he's trying to hump the text and logos, just as he's about to bash your face with the Donkey Kong sledgehammer. This guy is crazy! He's wrestling bears, drinking gasoline, riding a bull on a highway, playing baseball with his cock! He just went mental and started a rampage through a construction area. All the workers are falling to their doom. Look at the poor guy still holding his jackhammer as he plummets from the top of the building. Notice that Harry's wearing the IREM logo on his belt buckle. Remember when Mario wore a Nintendo shirt? No, I don't think that ever happened, at least not on a cover. You know, this game was originally an arcade game in Japan, and it was ported to the Famicom first. Why didn't they just use the artwork from the Famicom version? Nah, it's gotta be fucking American and macho. I like how the title has a white box behind it, as if it wouldn't have stood out enough in front of the blue sky. It looks like they forgot to put it there, and then at the last minute, right before it went to the printers, somebody looked at it and went, oh fuck, we gotta put the title on there. Quick, quick, take it from the instruction manual or something. Hurry, cut it out, slap it on there. Hammer and Harry, a guy you don't wanna fuck with. Super Duper Sumos for Game Boy Advance. From Midway, the same company that brought you Mortal Kombat, now brings you three sumo wrestlers smashing their fat asses together. Dude, it's a cover for a game endorsed by Nintendo that advertises itself with asses being smashed together. It's Butt Bash 3000. They're all smiling, they like it. You can hardly see the third sumo wrestler in the background, and I know this is because it was from a TV show that had to include all three characters, but they couldn't figure out a way to make it so you can see all three of them. It throws off the symmetrical layout, and the shadows on the ground contradicts the absence of a light source on their cartoon-style bodies. Yeah, but who cares? They're bashing their butts together, ramming their rear ends, clashing their cabooses. Or maybe not. I first assumed that the action graphic in the middle was meant to represent the impact of their hinies hitting, but maybe they're actually pressing their asses together, just holding them there, and then farting simultaneously. Blowing farts up each other's assholes, creating an explosion. The combined farts of three giant hamster-shaped men creates a blast more powerful than a nuclear bomb. It's so powerful that it sent them into an alternate dimension. You see the city in the background? Just barely, right? That's because their reality is fading away as they enter the next dimension. This is science here. This is time travel. When Doc Brown needed plutonium, that's because he didn't want to have to get the gas from three sumo wrestlers doing butt slams. Ultimate Stuntman for NES. Somebody clearly wanted to create the most masculine cover ever. Guns, sports cars, throw it all in. The meat-headed message seems to be clear. Gun plus car equals awesome. This is no ordinary stuntman. This is the ultimate stuntman. Is this a guy who does stunt work, or does he go around shooting bad guys? It's a stuntman turned action hero. Notice the big bird, which is partly obscured by the words. It's holding a star as if to deliver it to the man, and something is randomly exploding behind him, just to break up the monotony. There wasn't enough going on. How about the car? Well, it's a car, which makes perfect sense when juxtaposed against a squid. What, a fucking squid? What is it doing? Halfway hidden near the man's crotch. He's so macho, he's holding up the squid with his dick. Ugh, I can't look at it all at once. It's hitting my brain too hard. Let's view it just a bit at a time. Okay, ultimate stuntman, bird, action guy, I get it. I'm with it still. Okay, that's where I draw the line. If awesome overload was the whole point, then where's the hot chick, where's the sunglasses, the dinosaurs, the robots? I don't think they got enough stuff on here. Look at all the wasted space. This is one of those unlicensed games. It's one of those gold cartridges. The squid gets mostly cut off. If you had the cartridge without the box, you'd be wondering what the hell that is. On the back, it says, do not drop, do not get wet, do not leave in direct sunlight. Can you feed it after midnight? Then there's that weird switch. What does that do? Position B. Only use this position if the game does not work with position A. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. X-Man for Atari 2600. Wow. I don't know what part of this picture is demanding the most attention. The woman who's in the process of stripping down to her bare body, or all the crazy shit going on over there? The woman is depicted in a realistic way. Lots of detail has gone into the shape of her body, the lighting, and the tones of her skin. Sure, her nose is a little flat, but the guy on the right is a full-blown caricature style. He has no neck, exaggerated teeth and eyes. Those two different styles are so distant from one another that I don't even think the same artist created them both. Or it's meant to portray the separation between the glamorous supermodel and the geeky, insecure guy. But let's not skip over the title, X-Man. X-Man? To quote a line from Enter the Dragon, you come right out of a comic book. A Marvel comic book published on September 10th, 1963 by Stan Lee and Jack Kirby. You know, X-Men? Not just the name, the logo itself. It may not be identical, but it comes pretty damn close. Well, X-Men didn't turn the M into a crotch. They missed out on that. What does X-Man mean anyway? It's on the dude's shirt too, or half of a shirt, whatever he's wearing. I suppose because it's a pornographic game, one I missed in my Atari porn episode, that the X means like triple X, man, I don't know. What about the fact that he's grabbing his crotch? When I see a man grabbing his crotch next to a pair of runaway scissors, that can't be good. Or what about crabs? Oh, no, I'm not gonna explain that one. Or the Twizzler mouth making yet another appearance. What's up with that? All these things are after his crotch. He's trying to protect his crotch from the risks involved in paying this hooker as he runs through the never-ending maze of sexual frustration. But he's smiling. There's some kind of joy to it. And that's when I noticed, with the position of his hands, you should be able to see both hands, but you only see one. That must mean that his right hand is going through the opening of his underwear. He's jerking off. That's what I call a video game cover. Pretty good video for Christmas Day, huh? I give you X-Man for X-Miss. Triple X-Miss. A woman getting ready to show her tits, a guy with his hand down his crotch. It's filthy, but you wouldn't want it any other way, would you? Merry Christmas, you filthy animals.